Good morning. We invite you to rise as we begin with a call to worship found in the first page of your bulletins. Jesus, remember me. When you come into your kingdom, we welcome you to worship this morning, and if you are visiting with us, we invite you to fill out the yellow visitor card found in the pews right in front of you. We begin the season of Lent at the baptismal font, remembering that it is here that our sins have been washed away. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, in deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We open our hymnals to hymn number 319, O Lord, throughout these 40 days.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy, Lord.
For the reign of God and for peace throughout the world, for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For your people here who have come to give you praise, for the strength to live your word, let us pray to the Lord.
Mercy, Christ, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, and defend us, O God.
Let us pray. Lord God, our strength, the struggle between good and evil rages within and around us, and the devil and all the forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's be seated for the lessons.
A reading from the book of Genesis.
The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now, the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Spirit. words I speak, my God, to my unuttered sighs attend, and from your overwhelming throne to my frail spirit grace extend. God is kind and gracious, God heals the broken spirit. For early shall my prayers ascend, like incense rising to the sky. In confidence I make my plea, and in your love and truth rely. God is kind and gracious, God heals the broken spirit. Your heart delights in all things good, and evil flees if you are there. Your truth will over pride prevail, and justice shall be brought to bear. God is kind and gracious, God heals the broken spirit. But through your boundless truth and love, among your chosen I am cast. Oh, lead me forth in your true way, and bring me safely home at last. God is kind and gracious, God heals the broken spirit.
A reading from the book of Romans. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death spread to all because all have sinned, sin was indeed in the world before the law. But sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgressions of Adam, who is a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass, for if the many died through the one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift in the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. And this free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin, for the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If, because of the one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
stand as we welcome our gospel this morning.
Lord, let my heart
according to St. Matthew.
Lord,
this part of the story takes place right after Jesus is baptized. The story that Matthew tells is that Jesus is baptized and immediately goes into the wilderness, which wouldn't have been trees in Israel, would have been desert and rocks. So Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was famished. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." And then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." And Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." So again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world with all of their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." And with that, the devil left him. And suddenly angels came and they waited upon him. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise
you, O Christ. You may be seated. So, when I was 17, on a porch in West Toledo, I leaned over and gave a long and what I thought was a passionate kiss to Ann Weaver, which would be unremarkable, I suppose, at 17, except Ann Weaver was my girlfriend's best friend and my best friend's girlfriend. So there was all sorts of ugly stuff in that. And in thinking back about this, you know, you could see all those steps that kind of led to that final bad decision that was made. The long phone conversations that we were sharing at the time, back when phones had cords and you hid in the closet to hide from your mom. The sudden interest I took in tennis, even though I'd never been interested in tennis before, but Ann played tennis for the high school. The minor sparks that had been seen between us that I ignored, that she ignored. So that when after our late night tennis game, she said, "Karl, do you want to come in for some lemonade on my porch?" The right answer for me would have been no. And then when I sat down, I could have sat over there rather than right on the swing next to her with our legs touching. And I did none of those things. I gave in to all that temptation. And that one kiss caused all sorts of heartache and headache in our high school lives. These stories today from Genesis and from Matthew, they're all about temptation. And the center of Adam and Eve's temptation is whether to eat that fruit or not, that's in that one tree that's off limits. And the serpent in the story just plays a real minor role. Really, all the serpent is doing is kind of running through the arguments that Adam and Eve have surely had in their own head, just saying the stuff that they were already thinking. I mean, look at it. The serpent doesn't dazzle them with these arguments. The serpent doesn't put a spell, an evil spell over them, doesn't badger them into eating that fruit. The serpent, in fact, doesn't even lie, just speaks the truth, slanted, as Emily Dickinson wrote. The truth slanted, truthiness, as Stephen Colbert might say. And they ate, right? They gave in to that temptation. And temptation is going to make each and every person in this room stumble. In fact, let me say that differently. You have all stumbled over temptation in every part of your lives. And whether you succumb to it or resist it, it's out there calling you, right? And sometimes the consequences of stumbling into that temptation are dire, and sometimes they're minor. But the one thing about temptation is we don't even grow out of it, right? I mean, we might be tempted by different things at 52 than we were at 17, but we're still always tempted. And the heart of temptation seems to be to make us do something that's going to harm ourselves, possibly, our neighbor, or our God. The heart of this temptation for Adam and Eve is whether they can trust that God still has their best interest at heart, right? Does God's word still mean something to me? Is God's no a maybe or a sometimes? They asked and answered the question, does God care about me? And they answered, no. I think this is a better route to go. And they ate that fruit. And then you saw what happened. What happens next is kind of interesting, right? The very next part of that story is the whole naked thing in the story. Which, personally, I'm pretty sure that God was going to get rid of that in the Garden of Eden anyways. I got to believe that was a mistake from day one. Sunburn, chafing, just seeing things that no one really wants to see anyways. We've got neighbors that share too much, right? It's never a good idea, men, to mow your lawn without a shirt on. So stop doing it today. Heavenly hosts, we're going to gather and have a meeting and go, I move we stop these people from running around naked. And Adam and Eve just moved up that timetable. But the naked thing wasn't about sunburn, chafing, or exposing things that shouldn't be exposed. Wanting to cover up wasn't even about being embarrassed in front of each other. They stitched those fig leaves together because of they were embarrassed in front of God. That naked thing is a good symbol for how we feel when we've been exposed, when we've given in to temptation. And we've been found out. When the person that trusted us finds out we've got feet of clay. Because at some point, we're going to have to call our 17-year-old best friend and tell him that we just kissed his girlfriend. At some point, we're going to have to confront our spouse or co-worker or our God with what's been happening. And that very day, we're going to have to look in the mirror at who we are and who we become with that little piece of powdered sugar on the mouth, right? I mean, that one donut that tempted you all day long at the office that you just walked by faithfully because you're dieting. And then you grabbed right at the end of the day. And it didn't even taste good because it was dry and yucky and ugly. And then you looked in the rearview mirror and there it was, just a little powdered sugar mocking you. This is the drama of our lives. Each and every one of us gives in to temptation in the midst of our days. Exposing ourselves, feeling naked and ashamed for what we've done. And I don't know if I have any wisdom to share with you on how to resist temptation. I'm guessing that if we gathered together, we could come up with some good strategies. Like, maybe when you're walking by that donut, sing a song so that serpent stops calling you. I don't know. Read a book. One thing we can do is we can imagine what it will be like to confess to our friend or neighbor what we've done. How's this going to play out for us? We can imagine at the end of time standing before God and having a reel of our highlights of all the worst things we've done played out. Hopefully that's not the judgment God's got in store for us. Or we could just simply pray, Lord, get me off of this porch, please. But there is one thing we can do, and there is one thing we can preach as church together. When I got home that night, I got out that phone that had dials and cords and everything else, because I couldn't call. I had to explain this to someone at 9:30. I couldn't call in the car. I had to wait till I got home. I called my friend, and I told him that I just kissed his girlfriend. And I kid you not, DJ, before the end of the conversation, forgave me fully, because he is still one of the most Christ-like people I know. I told my girlfriend the next day, and that did not go nearly as well. For a couple months, that was kind of rocky. Eventually, she ended up marrying me, but Lord, it was rough. But both of their reactions is something for us to ponder for a minute, right? That God gives us the ability to love each other when we're broken and ashamed. Even when we can't forgive ourselves for what we've done. Hopefully we'll find neighbors in church and community that can forgive us. Hopefully we'll find someone to cover us in our shame. We can be that for each other, and we should be, because it's in our DNA. We are made in the image of God, and God's very character is grace and forgiveness. So God stitched together better clothes for Adam and Eve, because those fig leaves just weren't going to cut it. And God found a better place for them to live, because the Garden of Eden wasn't going to work out any longer. God met them in their brokenness, exactly who they were, and covered them with his love. And that's what God will do for us when we give in to temptation. The only thing is, God can't unwind the consequences of our actions or heal quickly the hurt of what we've done. For that, we have to linger and pray for. Amen. Chosen another Lenten hymn, hymn 606. Please open that up and stand, and let's sing together. Gathered as the people of God, let us pray for the church and the world and for all those we know are in need of prayer this morning. Holy God, make us strong and courageous in the face of our temptations. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Holy God, fill this church with grace and forgiveness to cover all those who have fallen to temptation so they know they are loved. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Holy God, make us a loving people in this country and in all countries, welcoming those broken and naked. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those who are struggling today in broken relationships, whose hearts are broken. We pray especially for those who are grieving, the Pinion family and the Sharp family. We pray for those who are sick or ill. Especially we lift up Lexi and Lowry, and Todd and Pat and Paul, and Joyce and Joe Jameson, and Chris Reed. We pray for Kimberly and Meg and Earl and Harlan, Tracy and Will, and Christine and David, and Linda, and Pat, Harold, and Susan, Dorothy, Lauren, Holly, Daryl, and Wes, Alicia, Jim, Arlia, Denise, and Roger, Al and Betty, John Vanover, and Ted Morrison, both with major surgeries this week. We pray for Paul Newell as he begins a deployment, and we celebrate with Mandy and Max 10 years of marriage. And we give time now for other prayers to be lifted up. Hear all these, God. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we trust you in this prayer. Whatever your will deems, we will say yes to. We pray with the confidence of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please share God's love and God's peace with one another. While you share the good gifts that God gave to you, bring this morning.
invite you to stand as we sing. Merciful God, receive the sacrifice of our praise and thanksgiving and the offering of our lives, that following in the way of the cross, we may know the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. With joyful hearts, let us join in with all the saints and sing this unending hymn. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, you have brought us this far along the way. And you have given to us your only Son. And in that Son, in that promise, you have freed us from the bonds of temptation, prejudice, oppression, sin. And we remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we await the day when Jesus shall return to free all the earth from the bonds of slavery and death. Come, Lord Jesus, and let the church say, Amen. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit in your church without end. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are welcome to this table God has set.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated as we invite our communion assistants forward, and then all may come forward for this bread and wine. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace.
Amen.
Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us this Lent on our pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I have a few announcements. As always, we continue to ask you to fill out our congregational survey. The hard copies are out in the Welcome Center. You can also go to the website and click on the link. The more people who respond, the sooner we'll stop asking. So how about that for a motivation, right? All right, so please fill the survey out as we continue to discern a vision for Messiah the next coming years. And then come on out for our Lenten Wednesdays through this season. We have our Messiah Night Dinner at 5:30, and then a series taught by Pastor Al Debelak, who's a great pastor and teacher. So come on out for that. The description is in your bulletin board. And then our service at 7:30, a time of evening prayer and just a peaceful service, about a half an hour. So come on out for that on Wednesday nights. Also, out in the Welcome Center, there's a sign-up sheet for a getting to know you party to get to know people. So this is March 12th at the house of Kay and Doug Arnold. They're hosting this just for an opportunity for members of Messiah to have a gathering in a welcoming, homey place, and with refreshments and just time to talk and chat and get to know one another. So you can go out in the Welcome Center and put your name down for March 12th. It should be a really great time, all ages, all cross services, so come on out for that. Also in the Welcome Center, you can find out more information for ordering paver stones. This will be through the month of March, so you can look in your bulletin board and also out in the Welcome Center for information on that. And then, finally, we had a really great Mardi Gras party last night. A lot of fun. The kids wore their masks. I was wearing a costume as well. And, yeah. And we had just a really good time of games and music and really great food. Pastor Karl and I also got a lot of whipped cream in the face, which if you're looking for evidence of that, you can find that on Facebook. There are many pictures and videos taken. So, Pie the Pastor, we called it. So, apparently you all really like to do that. And we raised about $500 to $600. We also have a lot of cupcakes left over, so please feel free to take a cupcake in the fellowship hall. If you are able, you can drop a little bit of cash in the donation basket, but really feel free to take cupcakes. We can even send some home with you, so enjoy those. And with that, I invite you to stand for a benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you God's peace. Amen. Let's go forth with our sending hymn. Go in peace and serve the Lord.